Picture the scene, it's 1970. We're in Hawaii with Jimi Hendrix and a very hippie crowd. At the height of the psychedelic era, no, this is not a dream. Some of these images have never been seen before. The documentary Music Money Madness tells the story of one of Hendrix's very last trips, a gig in paradise. And when Jimi Hendrix wasn't on psychedelic tours, he lived here at number 23 Brook Street in London's West End. This was his actual bedroom, and the girlfriend he lived with, Kathy Etchingham, said he loved it here because he could smell the traffic fumes outside, and he would love nothing more than being domesticated and popping around the corner to his favourite shop, John Lewis. Inside Jimi Hendrix's old flat, now turned museum. Fun fact for you, Beatle George Harrison used to stay in the spare room here, back when Hendrix would blast his speakers so loud that he broke them. In the swinging 60s, rock stars sat here.
He was wild and, you know, burned his guitar and played it with his teeth and, you know, was really extrovert. But Kathy Etchingham, who he lived here with, tells stories of him drinking cups of tea and watching Coronation Street.
Jimi Hendrix watched Corrie.
Apparently.
I can't quite believe it.
As well as being this amazing musician, he had a kind of domestic, more chilled side to him.
Now that gig in Maui, we are at, we take ourselves back there, we are at peak psychedelic era.
Yeah.
What was going on? It looks very chaotic, Sean.
Wild. There are some interesting facts about that concert, such as they separated the audience by star sign. So, you know, all the Scorpios had to sit in one section, all the Aquariuses over there, which is just brilliant.
Jimi Hendrix was, at the time of this performance, the highest paid rock star in the world, having headlined Woodstock the year before. You've probably heard less, though, about the time Hendrix headlined the Glidodrome in Boston, Lincolnshire. It was 1967. Anthea Connell remembers it very well. She was 19, and her boyfriend's band were supporting Hendrix that night.
What was it like to be in the presence of Jimi Hendrix? What was his aura like?
I can't tell you how astonished I was when, as you know, just a young kid sitting there quietly minding our own business, having a Coke or whatever I was doing, and I suddenly saw him get off the stage and he was heading towards me, and I thought, he can't be coming towards me. I've no idea why he came over and gave me this wonderful message, and it reads, to Anthea, love and kisses to you forever. I wish I could really talk to you. And he underlined the word really. And then he put, stay sweet, Jimi Hendrix. I was just astonished, you know, just me, nobody from Nottingham. Why would he do this? But he did.
You're not nobody, you're Anthea Connell from Nottingham.
Well, yes.
Meanwhile, back in paradise, and this was to be one of Hendrix's last ever performances before his death at 27 after overdosing on sleeping tablets.
You have to remember, Hendrix only has 8 more weeks to live after this. It's right towards the end of his career and his life. I think his significance now is not in people who try to imitate his sound at that time, but say in hip-hop music, where he's been sampled and his work gets reignited.
Stuff. That's all we have time for.